Y'all ready for the word of God? Amen. Well, I'm excited to have one of the daughters of the house come and minister the word. And she is phenomenal. Not somebody that just ministers, but lives the life outside the church. Amen. And we're excited. But let's give the Lord some praise for Miss Abigail Jones as she comes and ministers the word. Come on up.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Let's go ahead and begin by praying and praise God. Thank you, Father, for this night. Lord, Father, we thank you for allowing us, Lord Jesus, to be here once again, Father, gathered here together, Lord Jesus, to worship and uplift your name, God. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for each and every day that you give us, God, the health that you give us, Lord Father, the strength, the wisdom, Father, to be able to walk, Lord Father, with you, Lord Jesus, through this journey, God. And I just want to thank you, Father, for this opportunity, God. I'm honored to bring your word, Lord Father. I just pray that all our hearts be open to receive here tonight, God. Cast out any situations, Lord Father, that may try to hinder, Lord Father, or drown out your voice, Lord Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, God. I thank you, Father. And we worship you, God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. You guys may be seated. Praise God. That worship was powerful, huh? Man, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I want to begin by reading in the book of Hebrews. And the title of my message this evening is Becoming Purposely Driven by God. Amen. Hallelujah. And I'm going to be using a lot of different versions, but I'm going to begin with the Passion Translation here in Hebrews 11, verse 23 through 27. Praise God. Hallelujah. How you guys doing tonight? Good? Amen. Praise God. All right. Hebrews 11, verse 23 through 27 says this. Faith prompted the parents of Moses at his birth to hide him for 3 months because they realized their child was exceptional and they refused to be afraid of the king's edict. Faith enabled Moses to choose God's will, for although he was raised as a son of Pharaoh's daughter, he refused to make that his identity, choosing instead to suffer mistreatment with the people of God. Moses preferred faith's certainty above the momentary enjoyment of sin's pleasures. He found his true wealth in suffering abuse for being anointed, more than in anything the world could offer him. For his eyes looked with wonder, not on the immediate, but on the ultimate. Faith's great reward. Holding faith's promise, Moses abandoned Egypt and had no fear of Pharaoh's rage because he persisted in faith as if he had seen God who is unseen. Hallelujah. Wow. Praise God. Let's go on right above to verse 17 through verse 19. Verse 17 through verse 19 right above says, faith operated powerfully in Abraham, for when he was put to the test, he offered up Isaac. Even though he received God's promises of descendants, he was willing to offer up his only son, for God had promised, through your son Isaac, your lineage will carry on your name. Abraham's faith made it logic to him that God could raise Isaac from the dead. And symbolically, that's exactly what happened. Hallelujah. Having faith in God's word will bring logic to an illogical situation where your best thinking is nothing compared to not even God's starting point of where he's going to take you. There was certainty in Moses' faith. He found a vital key to success as a Christian, and it was he stayed focused not on the ultimate, not on the immediate, but on the ultimate. Amen. Look at your neighbor and ask, are you looking at the bigger picture? Hallelujah. Or are you just looking at what's in front of you? Now, the enemy will try to keep your vision limited to what seems natural or normal. But God is a God of the supernatural. Hallelujah. And God who exceeds our wildest dreams and imaginations. This is a God who made the universe. Let's go to Genesis, back to the basics. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 1. Hallelujah. Just to get a glimpse of God's power and imagination. Hallelujah. His creativity. Hallelujah. And I'm going to use the NIV to read this portion here. Genesis 1, verses 1 through 27 says, praise God. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, let there be a vault between the waters to separate water from water. So God made the vault and separated the water under the vault from the water above it. And it was so. God called the vault sky. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear. And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds. And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the vault of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them serve as signs to mark sacred times and days and years. And let them be lights in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth. And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the vault of the sky. So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living thing with which the water teems and that moves about in it, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the water in the seas and let the birds increase on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make mankind. Oh, here we go. In our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Wow. Hallelujah. I don't know about y'all, but it sounds like God's imagination is way better than mine. Hallelujah. Much more incredible. Hallelujah. So we can pray to God with specific things in mind and walk away knowing that he's about to supersede all that we just asked for. Have confidence in the Lord. Hallelujah. He wants what's best for you. And because that's the God we serve. Now, we speak Ephesians 3:20 every service, after every service. What do we say? Stop. Let's start again. Now, unto him who is able. Stop. Do you hear it? Now unto him who is able. He's able. Hallelujah. That's why it's so important to trust the Lord, to allow him and give him room to show his greatness. Hallelujah, because he's able. Amen. Even in the small things, do we really trust the Lord? Hallelujah. Or are we holding on to what we can see? That's what Pastor was talking about a little bit ago. I don't know how to pronounce that word, man. Familiarity. There you go. Bomb. Come on, somebody. Holy Ghost said to me during this teaching, everything doesn't have to be palpable for it to be possible. Hallelujah. Now, what happens is, what kicks in when we believe something for the Lord, or we're believing in something for the Lord, is what I like to call the if factor. Can you pull that up? The if factor. No? All right. The if factor, if you want to write it down. To me, this means immediate fear. IF. Immediate fear kicks in when you're praying to the Lord and you're declaring something over your life, over your family's life, over your finances, over your home. Do not walk away from that prayer second guessing, contradicting what you just spoke. There is no if factor. God is going to move, and he's going to move according to when you speak his authority. Amen. Hallelujah. Do not let the if factor, hallelujah, hinder the glory of God. Immediate fear starts to try to kick in to keep that blessing from showing up. Hallelujah. Let's rebuke that thing in the name of Jesus. We got to be people of God that believe, that really trust. It's easy to say, I trust you, Lord. But when the storms come, do we trust? Will we walk upon the waters? Hallelujah. Will we trust the Lord? Hallelujah. Come on. So God says, pray, reach out. Pray for vision beyond the point of comprehension. Challenge yourselves, in other words. Hallelujah. Don't just stay with the familiar. Don't just stay with the comfortable. Challenge yourselves when you're praying to the Lord and believing something in God. Hallelujah. Your promise is bigger than your problems. Oh, y'all like that? All right. Your promise is bigger than your problems. Hallelujah. That's why you're getting attacked. That is why you are getting attacked. It's not time for you to die. It's time for you to rise. Rise up in the name of Jesus when the attacks come. It's not time to run. It's not time to hide. You have to rise up in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You hold a certain value and the enemy knows it. So he's going to try to knock you out. Hallelujah. Arise. Let your light shine for all to see. For the glory of the Lord rises to shine on you. Darkness as black as night covers all the nations of the earth, but the glory of the Lord rises and appears over you. All nations will come to your light. Mighty kings will come to see your radiance. Look and see, for everyone is coming home. Woo! Everybody is coming home. Come on! Yes! Your sons are coming from distant lands. Come on! Your little daughters will be carried home. Come on! Your eyes will shine and your heart will thrill with joy. For merchants from around the world will come to you. They will bring you the wealth of many lands. Hallelujah. Praise God. So if you're running away, when the wealth comes, you're not going to be there to receive it. Come on. Hallelujah. The devil knows, man. The enemy knows that if you're not in your position, when the blessing is coming, you're going to miss it. Hallelujah. Let's resurrect, people of God. Let's rise up, people of God. Hallelujah. What I just read there was from Isaiah chapter 60. That was verse 1 through 5. Ooh, shakala baba. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's go to Luke. Luke chapter 12, verse 48. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's why I always sing that, take courage, take courage. Because I know the days are evil. I know they're hard. Hallelujah. But we got to stand. We got to be strong in the Lord. Amen. Take authority. Amen. It says here, I'm gonna read the King James Version first, and then I'm going to go to the Passion Translation of the same book, chapter and verse, which is Luke 12:48. King James Version says, But he that knew not and did commit things worthy of stripes shall be beaten with few stripes. For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be much required. Excuse me. And to whom men have committed much of him, they will ask the more. And then the Passion Translation says this. But the servant who does not know his master's will and unwittingly does what is wrong will be punished less severely because he does not know the master's will. For those who have received a greater revelation from their master, who has received a greater revelation in this house? Amen. We're all upgraded in here. from their master are required a greater obedience. And those who have been entrusted with great responsibility will be held more responsible to their master. There it is. Hallelujah. So, like I was saying earlier, don't find it strange that you are being consistently attacked. I was listening to a conversation T.D. Jakes was having with Pastor Furtick, and he said this: the reward of your last challenge is your next challenge. Man, when he said that, I was like, woo! Oh, come on, man. That's right. The reward of your last challenge is your next challenge. Hallelujah. When you're feeling like you're being crushed, pulled, stretched, that's God's way of showing you something big is about to happen. Like it said here in Luke 12:48, to whom much is given, much is required. Don't run, don't hide, don't move. Be still. Hallelujah. Amen. There's no time to dwell on the pain or that discomfort that you're feeling because, oh yes, there is discomfort. It is uncomfortable. But in this very moment, know that there is preparation and new levels of growth that are taking place during this time. And your motivation to stick to the initial plan should be found in knowing that our God is never failing. Remember, God is never failing, and that all things work together for the good of those who love him. Come on. The greater the challenge, the greater the blessing. The greater the challenge, the greater the blessing. That's why God in this very moment is emphasizing so much on faith. So much on trusting in him, because that's when we have to activate it the most. Amen? In these moments where it all seems lost, when the seas have become violent, and the waves are beating up against your ship, and you're losing your balance, and you're calling out for help, and you feel like you're drowning, and there's nobody around, and it's cold, and it's dark, know that in this time of pressure, God is preparing you for his great reward for your life. Amen? Do you not know that Jesus had to endure pain in order to transfigure into his ultimate position? Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 13, hallelujah, verse 4 in the Passion Translation. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4. Let's read a little bit about that, hallelujah, so that we know and can remember that we're not alone, that our Lord and Savior went through the same situations, the same obstacles, hallelujah, praise God. It says here, for although he was crucified as a weakling, now he lives robed with God's power. Hallelujah. And we also are weak ones in our co-crucifixion with him. But now we live in God's triumphant power together. You're not alone. You live in God's triumphant power together with him. Amen? Let's look at this word co-crucifixion. Wanted to visit this really quickly. I had some of the brothers make a handout because there are certain things I wanted to pinpoint. And for the sake of time, I didn't want to go through each thing individually tonight. But you will be able to take home a handout, and it will be there for you to revisit. Amen? Co-crucifixion. Do you understand what the term co-crucifixion means? Here's a simple way to remember it. Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and we die onto the cross to our sins. So that's the difference, amen? Now listen to this. Many say they have faith in Christ for salvation, but when it comes to applying their faith to practical living, some are not trusting God with the Father, as did Jesus. Do not dare to allow yourself to say, well, I'm not Jesus. The very purpose of God is to shape you into the likeness of his Son now in today's world. Amen? Ask yourself these questions. I have five questions I want you guys to reflect on. Amen? If you could pull that up real quick. There it is. Question number one. Do you trust God explicitly in every circumstance, be it good or bad? Think about that. Do we really trust God explicitly in every circumstance? Not just what's comfortable, not just what we're used to or accustomed to, not just what the hurts a little bit, but in good and bad. Question number two. Are you convinced that he is working all things for your good? Hallelujah. Question number three. Do you lash out in difficult times as though God is being a bad father? Guilty sometimes. Yeah, man, it makes you think, doesn't it? Question number four. Do you respond to disagreeable people with a critical spirit? Hallelujah. Question number five. When life is not going your way, do you make things miserable for others? Hallelujah. Be honest in your answers. This will help you to know whether you are truly dying to self on the cross. Another way you are relying upon Jesus' death, are you relying upon Jesus' death to get you into heaven, but not dying to yourself so that God can build heaven into you? I'm going to repeat that. Man, I love it when he ministers to me while I'm up here. It's like, praise God, this is good. Amen. It says, are you relying upon Jesus' death to get you into heaven, but not dying to yourself so that God can build heaven into you? Hallelujah. There is no area of spiritual growth that will challenge you more than co-crucifixion. Dealing with your old man, your old self, amen? Your old sinful nature will fight from its fortress of self-defense using everything from arguments to explanations and excuses to blame. All the while, however, you are protecting self-enslavement. It's bondage. There's no hell deeper than that of self-rule. There's no liberation greater than co-crucifixion with Christ. Hallelujah. We must die. We must die. Hallelujah. That old man must die in order for the new man to live. So transfiguration takes sacrifice. It does take pain. Don't fear the pain. Fear what will happen if you give up. Do not fold if it's getting hard. If the pressure is on, then the blessing is coming. If the pressure is on, then the blessing is coming. The enemy knows that if you learn to completely trust and rely on the Lord, you can become unstoppable. You'll be put on alert for any foolishness, right? And cut it at the door with power and authority. Hallelujah. We have power over sin, power over doubts, fears, sickness, depression, anxiety, division, all things that are not of the Lord. We have power and authority, hallelujah, to not allow them to take over, amen? And God wants to bring that to our memory here tonight, hallelujah. And every time you hear any messages about faith, that's what it's about, not giving in, not folding, amen? The enemy likes to limit the children of God through something called fear. Because in fear, we're focused on just one small point. Because if we were to break this so-called box that we're so comfortably living in, that requires more work, more sacrifice on our part. So because we like to live in the comforts of home, the comforts of just having a little bit to do for the kingdom of God, we never get to see God's glory in his fullness. Amen? There's a great blessing that comes from being open and willing to serve, no matter what may come, and being open and willing to be used by God. But that requires certain sacrifices on our part, some work to be put in. Amen? Let's reference the Bible on that. Let's go to James chapter 2. Praise God. Hallelujah. Be encouraged, people of God. We got the best deal. Come on. Hallelujah. Don't be deceived, because it's hard now. You're in the best place at the best time, the right place at the right time. Hallelujah. James chapter 2, verses 14 through 17. And then I'll jump over to verse 24 in that same chapter. James chapter 2, verses 14 through 17, the Passion Translation says this. My dear brothers and sisters, what good is it if someone claims to have faith but demonstrates no good works to prove it? How could this kind of faith save anyone? For example, if a brother or sister in the faith is poorly clothed and hungry, and you leave them saying, goodbye, I hope you stay warm and have plenty to eat, but you don't provide them with a coat or even a cup of soup, what good is your faith? So then faith that doesn't involve action is phony. Come on. Verse 24 continues to say, so now it's clear that a person is seen as righteous in God's eyes, not merely by faith alone, but by his works. Some of us don't like to work. Some of us just are comfortable watching everybody else in labor and being just the cheerleaders on the sidelines, amen? But God wants everybody to do their part, because everybody's going to receive a different blessing, an individual blessing. There's something far greater for you, just like it is for your neighbor, for your brother. Hallelujah. So it's individual what God wants to do. That's why it's important to build a relationship with the Lord. Amen? Sometimes it's not enough for us to just sit up under the word and worship him, then go home. There's more to that. And the way that we're going to see the Lord really move and glorify himself in us, is to make ourselves available. We got to get up, break the strongholds, break in the box. No more tunnel vision Christianity. You can't live off my faith, the pastor's faith, the leader's faith, your brother or sister's faith. Hallelujah. God wants you to have your own individual blessing. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. You have to be driven by your own hunger and thirst for me, says the Lord. Develop in me, God, a hunger and a thirst for you, God. Because the flesh is still creeping around. Hallelujah. Although we proclaim the word of God, we still have to deal with the desires of the flesh. Amen? And we got to cast that thing down. So we have to ask the Lord to help us. Ask the Lord to fill us with a hunger. Fill us with a thirst for the things that are of him. Amen? Are we really followers of Christ? Are we really followers of Christ? Then why do we still walk in fear? Fear, a spirit that has not been given to us by God. And yet we embrace it. We receive it. We lend it our time, our energy. And God says, enough. Enough. No more fear. Hallelujah. God has not given us the spirit of fear. Come on. Hallelujah. Let's go to John chapter 8, the Passion Translation. John chapter 8. Amen. Verses 31 through 47. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. John chapter 8, the Passion Translation, verses 31 through 47. Jesus said to those Jews who believed in him, "When you continue to embrace all that I teach, you prove that you are my true followers. For if you embrace the truth, it will release true freedom into your lives." Surprised by this, they said, "But we're the descendants of Abraham, and we're already free. We've never been in bondage to anyone. How could you say that? We will be released into more freedom." "I speak eternal truth," Jesus said. "When you sin, you are not free. You've become a slave in bondage to your sin. And slaves have no permanent standing in a family like a son does, for a son is a part of the family forever. So if the son sets you free from sin, then become a true son and be unquestionably free. Even though you are descendants of Abraham, you desire to kill me because the message I bring has not found a home in your hearts. Yet the truths I speak, I've seen and received in my father's presence, but you are doing what you've learned from your father." "What do you mean?" they replied. "Abraham is our father." Jesus said, "If you are really Abraham's sons, then you would follow in the steps of Abraham. I've only told you the truth that I've heard in my father's presence, but now you are wanting me dead. Is that how Abraham acted?" "No, you people are doing what your father has taught you." Indignant, they responded, "What are you talking about? We only have one father, God himself. We're not illegitimate." Hallelujah. Jesus said, "Then if God were really your father, you would love me, for I've come from his presence. I didn't come here on my own, but God sent me to you. Why don't you understand what I say? You don't understand because your hearts are closed to my message. You are the offspring of your father, the devil, and you serve your father very well, passionately carrying out his desires. He's been a murderer right from the start. He never stood with the truth, for he's full of nothing but lies. Lying is his native tongue. He is a master of deception and the father of lies. But I am the true prince who speaks nothing but the truth, yet you refuse to believe and you want nothing to do with me. Can you name one sin that I've committed? Then if I am telling you only the truth, why don't you believe me? If you really knew God, you would listen, receive, and respond with faith to his words. But since you don't listen and respond to what he says, it proves you don't belong to him and you have no room for him in your hearts." Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know how to identify if you're trusting in the Lord? When you have no plan B's. You stick to the initial plan. You trust in the Lord with the initial plan and follow through while you wait on the Lord. Amen? Stick to the initial plan. Trust the Lord. Believe in God. Respond to his message. Amen? You will be tested. You will be challenged. Like Jesus was here in John chapter 8. They were challenging him, asking him questions. But you will not be moved by criticism. You will not be moved by insults. You will not be moved by fears. You will stand your ground in Christ Jesus until the day we go up to meet with him. Hallelujah. Praise God. God is asking his people to examine yourselves. Hallelujah. There's a reason why we repeat cycles and go through the same problems every year, year after year after year, and we do not see progress, and it seems like there's a standstill. And God is calling to his people to make a move, to trust, to believe, to walk with authority, to know that although you did not see what you've been praying and asking for right at the second or the minute that you expected it, it's coming. And we have to trust. We have to trust in the Lord. Hallelujah. It says here, "Examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith." 2 Corinthians chapter 13. "Test yourselves. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you?" We have a tendency to forget who is in us. The fire, hallelujah, that is in us. because the circumstance, we allow it to overpower the truth. Amen? And God doesn't want us to continue every year to do the same thing. Every month, every moment, he wants us to reflect in that very moment where we're struggling. That's when we got to hit the knees. That's when we got to declare. That's when we got to speak. That's when we got to believe in the word of God. Amen? A lot of us cower and we stop coming to church and we want to be to ourselves. But God says no. Amen? Gather your brothers. Gather your sisters. Tell them what's going on. Amen? And together you guys will rise above the situation. Rise above the circumstance. Amen? Because God is going to fill you with that strength that you need. Amen? He's not a God that's going to leave you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Stay focused on the promise. There is certainty. The faith that Moses had was a faith of certainty. The faith that Abraham had was a faith of believing God's promises. God promised Abraham a lineage through his son. Therefore, when it came time to sacrifice his son, he was willing to go because he believed that his son would provide to him what God had promised. So he said, it's only logic that if I have to sacrifice my son, God would have to raise him from the dead so he could provide to me the promises that he initially gave to me. Amen? So that's the type of faith that God wants his people today to have. Amen? We got to stay focused. Hallelujah. Trust, believe, and know he's got you. Somebody once spoke something over my life and said this to me. Hallelujah. When I was kind of, you know, doubting something, they told me, you can do what you're being asked to do. You know why? Because God saw that situation, that problem before this day. And he still wanted you to do this, to do what you're being asked to do. He still called you. So whatever it is you're focusing on right now, thinking that it's not going to allow you to move or make the moves that you need to make, know that God saw this beforehand. He saw the problem beforehand. He saw the problem before you even knew of the problem, while you were sleeping in your bed so soundly. God was seeing the chaos. But right above your resting place, he touched you and he prepared you and he gave you what you needed. He equipped you, amen. You didn't even notice. And when you get up and you rise above that and you face that challenge, God knows that the outcome is going to be victory. So that's why we cannot fear. Although it may seem impossible, although it may seem that we cannot get through, know that God saw it beforehand and he still chose you. He still called you. He still hand-selected you for that job, for that mission, for that calling. So there's no need to be afraid. When things are turbulent, when they're tossing, when they're turning, when people are divided, when people hate you, when people turn their backs on you, know that God already liberated you. He already took you out, and you already succeeded because he sees the future. We don't. So if we trust and believe, then we know that we're secure. We're going to be secure with the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. Praise God. Have courage, people of God. Have courage. Let's embrace the teachings of the Lord. Let's believe the Lord when he speaks a word in our lives. Amen? When we pray over any situation, when we pray about any circumstance, and we tell the Lord, this is what I need, Father, and give him details. He likes that stuff. Hey. Yes, what is it? Amen? Know that that initial plan, God is going to take that and he's going to run with it. He's going to supersede your imagination, your thoughts, your ideas of what they could have been. Amen? And it's going to be glorious. But you cannot dwindle. You cannot have these plan Bs, these what ifs, that immediate fear that kicks in. We cannot hinder God's glory and what he wants to do in your life by doubting that very thing that we just spoke that would happen and would come to pass. So we got to be very careful not to speak against what we believe in authority. Amen? Because there's some people, I've heard some leaders pray a prayer of power and authority over situations and people and then turn around and, and contradict what they just declare. Amen? And then God goes, oh, man, I was just about to move. I was just about to do something here. Hallelujah. But you got to stick to the initial plan. You got to understand that the Lord, when he's going to move, that's what he's going to do. Maybe not in your time, maybe not when you expect, but he's going to do it. Amen. And you walk away without any worry, just free of any cares for that thing that you just lifted up to the Lord. Don't worry about it no more. Pray about it. It's in God's hands. What better hands can it be in? Hallelujah. Right? Because sometimes we carry that thing everywhere we go. Yes, I prayed about it. I believed for it. But every time there's an altar call, you're back with the same, back with the same. And God wants to progress his people. But when we're too busy laboring over the same, in the same dry land, in the same fields, not producing fruit, and you're wondering, what's going on? I'm putting in this, I'm putting in that. Because you're going back to check on it all the time. That's not trust. You got to plant the seed. You got to believe. Water that thing. Walk away. Give it time. Because things take time to grow. Everything takes time to grow. Amen? We can't rush that process. That process is very vital. To get the outcome that you want, there's got to be a waiting period, folks. There's got to be a period, a moment where you're still in God, knowing that seed that you planted will grow. And when it's time, God's going to say, hey, go check on it. Back to the field. Ah, there it is. Amen. There it is. Trusting in the Lord. Amen. So God wanted us to realize, amen, that when we say we're trusting in him, that we have to really understand what trust is. That means we leave things in God's hands and allow him to move. Let him move. And let me tell you, the enemy is going to bring distraction. He's going to bring things into your life because he knows you're believing for that thing. And if you see it, you're going to believe even more. So he doesn't want you to see it, right? Because then your faith will grow. You'll become stronger because you'll become more confident when you see the result. Amen? So know that the enemy is going to try to deceive you and make you think, man, it shouldn't be taking this long. It should have already happened. Amen? And then you start shaking at the knees, sweating at the forehead, looking at the time, right? But God says, no, cast your cares on me. Amen? Be at peace. Be still. Hallelujah. What was happening with Christ when when they were in the sea and the ship was, what was the Lord doing? Come on, he knows a little something about being at rest, right? And how things still work out anyway. And that's the kind of faith I want to have, the one that Jesus had, where you just could just sleep it off. When somebody comes to you with any issues, tell them, sleep it off. Go sleep it off. Go do like Jesus. Go sleep it off. Amen? I got that from my house. Tell the kids, go to bed. You'll feel better in the morning. Mom, da-da-da. Go to bed. You'll see. Amen. Hallelujah. So that's all I have for you guys tonight. Amen. But I want to, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Woo!
I wanted to do this call for the altar call for the people of God, for all of us who want to and are longing for a faith like Abraham's, a faith like Moses, a faith like and a resting and arrive at a resting place like Jesus. Amen. So that we don't leave here tonight with any type of doubt or fear of whatever it is that we've been believing for anymore. God wants to develop in us a place where we can rest, a place that there's a time for everything. Amen. There's a time that we have to confront situations, and there's a time to leave it in God's hands and allow him to move. Amen. So for those of you who are longing for that peace, longing for that level of faith to arise in you, come up. Let's pray together. Hallelujah. So that we can come together in unity and pray this prayer together. Amen. And if the prayer team can come up here and help me out, go ahead and play this song by Micah Stampley. The song by Micah Stampley. And come on up, everybody who's longing to receive. Amen.
Oh, worship you in this place. Deeper prayer in this place. Greater consecration in this place. Oh. Burn it away.
Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Man, we can stay all night. Amen. Woo. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Have y'all been blessed tonight? Abigail, thank you, lady. Awesome, amen. Will you trust him? Not just say it, but when the storm hits, will you still trust him? In affliction, will you still trust him? Amen. God is faithful. He will do his part. Amen. Amen. Let's lift our hands up to the Lord. Father, we just thank you for that powerful word tonight. Father, seal it in our hearts, Father. Father God, help us to trust you when the storms rage, when the affliction comes, Father God, that we will still say we believe no matter what, Father. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Amen. Be blessed, people of God.
We've got it.